Penguin Random House Audio presents Blood Horses, Notes of a Sports Writer's Son. This is the author, John Jeremiah Sullivan. For MWS, 1945 to 2000, and for HPBM, 1917 to 2000. He had a sincere awe of the beasts around us, and he considered himself essentially on the same level with them, very closely related. Not through evolution, that poor man's religion, but through common destiny. Joaquin Seppel, The Animal Theme and Totemism in Franz Kafka, 1954. The Kid. It was in the month of May, 3 years ago, by a hospital bed in Columbus, Ohio, where my father was recovering from what was supposed to have been a quintuple bypass operation, but became, on the surgeons actually seeing the heart, a sextuple. His face, my father's face, was pale. He was thinner than I had seen him in years. A stuffed bear that the nurses had loaned him lay crooked in his lap. They told him to hug it whenever he stood or sat down, to keep the stitches in his chest from tearing. I complimented him on the bear when I walked in, and he gave me one of his looks, dropping his jaw and crossing his eyes as he rolled them back in their sockets. It was a look he assumed in all kinds of situations, but that always meant the same thing. Can you believe this? Riverside Methodist Hospital, the river being the Olentangy. My family had a tidy little history there, or at least my father and I had one. It was to Riverside that I had been rushed from a Little League football game when I was 12, both of my lower right leg bones broken at the shin, in such a way that when the whistle was blown and I sat up on the field after my first time carrying the ball all season, I looked down to find my toes pointing a perfect 180 degrees from the direction they should have been pointing in, at which sight I went into mild shock on the grass at the 50-yard line and lay back to admire the clouds. Only the referee's face obstructed my view. He kept saying, "Watch your language, son," which seemed comical since, as far as I knew, I had not said a word. I seem to remember, or may have deduced, that my father walked in slowly from the sidelines then, with the exceptionally calm demeanor he showed during emergencies, and put his hand on my arm and said something encouraging, doubtless a little shocked himself at the disposition of my foot. A little regretful, too, it could be, since he, a professional sports writer who had been a superb all-around athlete into his 20s, and a Little League coach at various times, must have known that I should never have been on the field at all. Running back was the only viable position for me, in fact, given that when the coach had tried me at other places on the line, I had tended nonetheless to move away from the other players. My lone resource was my speed. I still had a prepubescent track runner's build and was the fastest player on the team. The coach had noticed that I tended to win the sprints and thought he saw an opportunity. But what both of us failed to understand was that a running back must not only outrun the guards, typically an option on only the most flawlessly executed plays, but often force his way past them, knock them aside. Such was never going to happen. In fairness, the coach had many other things to worry about. Our team, which had no name, lacked both talent and what he called go. In the car headed home from our first two games, I could tell by the way my father avoided all mention of what had taken place on the field that we were pathetic. Not Bad News Bears pathetic, for we never cut up or wanted it or gave our all. At practice, a lot of the other players displayed an indifference to the coach's advice that suggested they might have been there on community service. The coach's son, Kyle, was our starting quarterback. When practice was not going Kyle's way, that is, when he was either not on the field, having been taken off in favor of the second stringer, who was excellent, or when he was on the field and throwing poorly, Kyle would begin to cry. He cried not childish tears, which might have made me wonder about his life at home with the coach and even feel for him a little, but bitter tears, too bitter by far for a 12-year-old. Kyle would then do a singular thing. He would fling down his helmet and run about 40 yards to the coach's car, a beige Cadillac Eldorado, which was always parked in the adjacent soccer field. He would get into the car, start the engine, roll down all four windows, and, still crying, I presumed, maybe even sobbing now, in the privacy of his father's automobile, play Aerosmith tapes at volumes beyond what the Eldorado's system was designed to sustain. The speakers made crunching sounds. The coach would put up a show of ignoring these antics for 5 or 10 minutes, shouting more loudly at us, as if to imply that such things happened in the sport of football. But before long, Kyle, exasperated, would resort to the horn, first honking it and then holding it down. Then he would hold his fist out the driver's side window, middle finger extended. The coach would leave at that point and walk very slowly to the car. While the rest of us stood on the field, he and Kyle would talk. Soon the engine would go silent. When the two of them returned, practice resumed with Kyle at quarterback. None of this seemed remarkable to me at the time. We were new to Columbus, having just moved there from Louisville, Kentucky. Our house had been right across the river in the Knobs above New Albany, Indiana. And I needed friends. So I watched it all happen with a kind of dumb animal acceptance, sensing that it could come to no good. And suddenly it was that final Saturday, and Kyle had given me the ball, and something very brief and violent had happened, and I was watching a tall, brawny man-child bolt up and away from my body, as though he had woken up next to a rattlesnake. I can still see his eyes as they took in my leg. He was black, and he had an afro that sprung outward when he ripped off his helmet. He looked genuinely confused about how easily I had broken. As the paramedics were loading me onto the stretcher, he came over and said he was sorry. At Riverside, they set my leg wrong. An x-ray taken 2 weeks later revealed that I would walk with a limp for the rest of my life if the leg were not rebroken and reset. For this, I was sent to a doctor named Moyer, a specialist whom other hospitals would fly in to sew farmers' hands back on, that sort of thing. He was kind and reassuring. But for reasons I've never been able to fit back together, I was not put all the way under for the resetting procedure. They gave me shots of a tranquilizer, a fairly weak one to judge by how acutely conscious I was when Dr. Moyer gripped my calf with one hand and my heel with the other and said, "John, the bones have already started to knit back together a little bit, so this is probably going to hurt." My father was outside smoking in the parking lot at that moment and said later he could hear my screams quite clearly. That was my first month in Ohio. 2 years after the injury had healed, I was upstairs in my bedroom at our house on the northwest side of Columbus when I heard a single fading, "Oh!" from the first floor hallway. My father and I were the only ones home at the time, and I took the staircase in a bound, terrified. Turning the corner, I almost tripped over his head. He was on his back on the floor, unconscious, stretched out halfway into the hall, his feet and legs extending into the bathroom. Blood was everywhere, but although I felt all over his head, I couldn't find a source. I got him onto his feet and onto the couch and called the paramedics, who poked at him and said that his blood pressure was all over the place. So they manhandled him onto a stretcher and took him to Riverside. It turned out that he had simply passed out while pissing, something we were told that happens to men in their 40s. He was at the time 45. The blood had all gushed from his nose, which he had smashed against the sink while falling. Still, the incident scared him enough to make him want to try again to quit smoking. To make him want to quit, anyway. One of countless doomed resolutions. My father was desperately addicted to cigarettes. It is hard for me to think about him, to remember him, without a ghostly neural whiff of tobacco smoke registering in my nostrils. And when I have trouble seeing him clearly, I can bring him into focus by summoning the yellowed skin on the middle and index fingers of his left hand, or the way the hairs of his reddish-brown mustache would brush the filter of the cigarette as he drew it in to inhale, or the way he pursed his lips and tucked in his chin when exhaling down through his nose, which he made a point of doing in company.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.